I say you're very welcome to those who are gathered here in the church and to those who will be watching at home later. And as we come to worship, our call to worship today will be taken from Psalm number 4. Psalm 4. Answer me when I call to you, my righteous God. Give me relief from my distress. Be merciful to me and hear my prayer. How long, O man, will you turn my glory into shame? How long will you love delusion and seek false gods? Know that the Lord has set apart the godly for himself. The Lord will hear when I call to him. In your anger, do not sin. When you are in your beds, search your hearts and be silent. Offer right sacrifices and trust in the Lord. Many are asking, who can show us any good? Let the light of your face shine upon us, O Lord. You have filled my heart with greater joy than when the grain and new wine abound. I will lie down and will sleep in peace, for you alone, Lord, make me dwell in safety. The thought of the Lord providing us with joy in our hearts that we can trust in him. Let's come and worship as we sing together. It's taken from the hymns and psalms, although the words will appear on the screen. Hymns and Psalms 6:3-5. Morning has broken like the first morning. And we can stand to sing together.
Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the world. Sweet the rains new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dew fall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where his feet. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light, Eden saw play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new day. Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the world.
and Miriam's going to come and lead us in our opening prayers.
Let us pray. Eternal Father, we praise and adore you, source of light and life. You speak to us through the wholeness of creation in all its beauty and splendor, making us one with you in body, soul, and spirit. Words we use to praise you are inadequate. You are the lifeblood that flows through us. In you we live and move and have our being. We confess we put riches before poverty of spirit, pride of self before humility, expecting others to understand us and agree with us when they see things differently. We confess that our love is only a shadow of yours. We do not listen with your heart and allow the differences to live alongside us. We confess that we have not respected your creation, taking from it what we need, polluting it, littering it, and not recycling earnestly. We confess that we are not the living Bibles for others to read, showing the fruit of the Spirit, and we are shy about using our gifts that you have given us to inspire others to come to you. Lord, forgive us and continue showing your endless patience with us as you transform our minds. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this earth, our homes and families, the wide sky and the sun, for the sea and running waters, for the everlasting mountains and the restless wind, for trees and the grass underfoot and the falling rain. We thank you for our senses, to smell the breath of spring, to hear the song of birds, to see the splendor of a colorful summer garden, to taste the autumn harvest, and soon, Father, to feel the touch of a caring and loving hand in ours. We offer these prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Redeemer. Amen. Let us join in saying the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Thank you, Miriam. In the church calendar, we are now past Easter, and we're heading towards Pentecost, and our focus begins to shift from that of the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead to the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, the promised Comforter, the Counselor who would come to the disciples. So really, when we begin to think about the coming of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, we need to be aware that it's the same Holy Spirit that is still poured out upon people today, upon those who believe today, so that they can be equipped to carry out the works of service and witness to which we've all been called. Our reading this morning will be taken from the book of Acts, Acts chapter 3, and it recounts an event that took place after the day of Pentecost. You remember how on Pentecost the Holy Spirit came and the disciples went out into the streets and proclaimed the gospel message of the risen Jesus Christ. Well, this is taken some time afterwards. And the scenario, I'm sure you'll recognize it, is Peter and John, two of those disciples, had went to the temple courts at the time of worship, the time of prayer. But as they entered the temple, through the gate called Beautiful, they encountered a beggar. And there he was healed, that beggar. Now, how could I describe to you what that actually looked like? It would take many words, wouldn't it? But perhaps if we watch this little clip of a film that depicts Peter and John meeting that beggar and what happened, it will help you to understand the setting that then moves on to cover our passage of Scripture. Nigel.
Anything to give? Alms?
Look on us.
Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk.
Do you think that engendered joy and wonder and splendor in the beggar? And what about those who had witnessed it? Those who were there on that day? We'll say more more about that in a few moments. But first, Let me read for you what happens after that. Acts chapter 3, beginning at verse 11. While the beggar held on to Peter and John, all the people were astonished and came running to them in the place called Solomon's Colonnades. When Peter saw this, he said to them, "Men of Israel, why does this surprise you? Why do you stare at us as if by our own power or godliness we made this man walk? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his servant Jesus. You handed him over to be killed, and you disowned him before Pilate. Though he had decided to let him go, you disowned the holy and righteous one and asked that a murderer be released to you. You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. We are witnesses to this. By faith in the name of Jesus, this man whom you see and know was made strong. It is Jesus' name and faith that comes through him that has given this complete healing to him. As you can see, now, brothers, I know that you acted in ignorance, and as did your leaders, but this is how God fulfilled what he had foretold through the prophets, saying that the Christ would suffer. Repent then and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped away, that times of refreshing may come from the Lord, and that he may send the Christ who has been appointed for you, even Jesus. He must remain in heaven until the time comes for God to restore everything, as he has promised long ago through the holy prophets. For Moses said, 'The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your own people. You must listen to everything he tells you. Anyone who does not listen to him will be completely cut off from among his people.' Indeed, all the prophets from Samuel on, as many as have spoken, have foretold these days. And you are heirs of the prophets and of the covenant God made with your fathers. He said to Abraham, 'Through your offspring, all people on earth will be blessed.' When God raised up his servant, he sent him first to you to bless you by turning each of you from your wicked ways." And we end there at verse 26. And we thank the Lord for that reading from his word. And we'll turn to song once more. And it's number 252 in Hymns and Psalms. All hail the power of Jesus' name.
Bring forth the royal.
There is a word that appears in that passage that in the culture of that time and place would have meant so much more than it does in our current setting today. That word is repent. You sometimes see up maybe on posters, on lampposts in various places, repent, the end is near. Have you ever saw those posters? And what's the general reaction to those when they're seen today? Laughter? Scoffing? That's what happens today. But in that particular culture, a call to repentance was maybe taken much more seriously than it is today. As we read through that there, you find Peter beginning to speak to this people. Now, this is after an act of worship. That man, the crippled man, was healed before the time of worship. Maybe in the clip you saw there, you heard the horn being sounded for them to come. This was the time for worship. So this is afterwards. And you can almost picture Peter and John together and that man with them, clinging onto them, holding onto them, and the crowd forming round them, wondering how has this happened. They were amazed. They were astonished at what had happened. And Peter said to them, if you think that this man's healing has come about because of any goodness or any righteousness or any power on our part, you're sadly mistaken. Rather, it is God, the God of your forefathers, of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob, who has performed this miraculous sign, who has performed this healing. Why? To the glory of his servant, Jesus. Jesus, do you remember that Jesus? Remember how a little while ago he came here, you welcomed him, and then a short time later, you called for him to be crucified? You were guilty of actually calling for his death, the suffering servant of Isaiah 53. God's anointed, God's appointed, that you would have said you were waiting for when he came to you. You declared that you want him put to death. Oh, Pilate, the Roman governor, was even wanting to set him free. But you said no. You shouted for him to be crucified and a murderer to be set free. Those people who would have been listening to Peter could have been thinking, did we get it so wrong that an innocent man suffered? Yes, they did. An innocent man had died. But really, in our culture of today, when we hear so much about violence and brutality, are we still moved by the thought of the innocent suffering? Think of some of the things that have been on news or in the newspapers recently. People seeking to peacefully protest being shot, or were you hearing recently about young men, young boys fleeing from their homeland because they were being forced to join an army to fight and they didn't want to? Or if they weren't used in battle, they were abused. They had to flee. Or what about exploitation of peoples? What about human trafficking? That happens on our doorstep. There seems to be so much violence and so much brutality in our world. Can we still be moved by the thought of the innocent suffering? Are we moved, or have we become immune to it? I wonder, were these people who were listening to Peter on that day, were they moved when he said to them, "You were responsible for an innocent man dying on a cross. You were responsible for the brutality that was there. You were responsible for that." Do you think he was trying to win friends and influence people? You know, we have heard much in the recent days, haven't we, about how the Duke of Edinburgh was quite forthright in what he said at times. That's one thing that you can say about Peter when you read through the Gospels. Peter's always the one to speak out. He's always the one to speak his mind. And here he was saying to the people, this man is healed because of faith in Jesus, the one that you agreed to put to death. Do you think he cut them to the quick or to the heart? But then you see, he went on and he said, but, there's always a but, isn't there? But God raised him from the dead. This is Jesus he's talking about. God raised him from the dead, and we are witnesses to it. And it's through faith in that Jesus that this man is healed. That this man is up and walking about to glorify his servant Jesus. This man has been healed. Faith in Jesus. Faith, it's a human activity, isn't it? It means believing in something. For the Christian, it's believing in Jesus Christ. But faith has another element to it as well. Faith is a gift. It's a gift from God to those who will believe, who will accept Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And as Peter told those people in Solomon's colonnades all those years ago, to believe and trust in Jesus, we are called to do the same today. To put our trust in him. We're called to turn from our wicked ways. We're called to repent of our sins and turn to our God. And what happens when we repent of our sins? What happens when we seek God's forgiveness for all the wrong that we have done in our lives? We are forgiven. We are forgiven. I wonder, I don't think this is probable that any of you can think back to actually going to school and writing on a slate. None of you that old, sure you're not, no? No. But can you remember the blackboards that they used to have at the front of the class? Do you remember going in on the first day of term in perhaps September? And the blackboard was lovely and black, wasn't it? And what was it like after the end of the first day? It was grey again. The chalk was there. And it progressively got whiter as the year progressed. And then when you went back in the following September, it was back to being completely black again. All wiped out. That's what happens to our sins when we seek forgiveness. It's completely wiped out. Completely cleared. There's nothing left on the slate. But there's more than that. Because Peter said to these people here, if you repent of your sins, that will allow God to pour out his Spirit, to have times of refreshing and blessing in your life. And if that happened for the believers, for those who would believe in Jesus then and repent of their sins. The same is true of us today. When we acknowledge Jesus as Lord, the suffering servant of God, when we acknowledge him as Lord and seek his forgiveness, the sins are past, and we are blessed with an infilling of the Holy Spirit to come and equip us, to empower us, to serve and to witness to the name of Jesus, the one who is our Lord. But we're called, first of all, to repent, to acknowledge our need of forgiveness. I was reading in preparation for this, and I came across an article by one writer, and he said that one of the largest groups of people who have not yet responded to the call to repent, and it's a group that would number over 1 billion, that, he claimed, was the nominal Christians. The nominal Christians. People who believe because, they were born into a believing family. People who believe because they're associated with a church or a particular denomination. That they're in a right relationship with God the Father. But they're not. Why not? Because they have never personally acknowledged Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. They have never repented of their sins. They have never drawn close. They have never known the joy of the infilling of God's Holy Spirit. That promised comforter, that promised counselor, who is poured out into the lives of those who will believe. Peter, in Solomon's colonnades, called on the people to repent for their sins and to know God's forgiveness. The call we can make today is that people today repent of their sins and know God's forgiveness. Know God's indwelling power. Know the ability to be shaped and molded to his will. To become more Christ-like every day. Christ came and died and rose again. The Holy Spirit was poured out and is still being poured out as we await the time of Christ's return. How are you waiting for Christ's return? Are you allowing him to dwell within you by faith? Are you allowing the Spirit to lead and guide you in the works of service that he has prepared for each one of us to perform? Are you waiting in joyful anticipation of a Savior who is Christ the Lord? Are you waiting in readiness, having repented and sought God's forgiveness? Let's take time to pray. Father, we approach your throne knowing that forgiveness comes through faith in your Son, Jesus Christ. Guide us in our lives. Speak into our hearts and challenge us that we might walk in the path that you set for us. And Father, as we come, we bring before you the needs that we see around us. We know that in recent days, Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth has been bereaved. Her husband, Prince Philip, after 73 years together in marriage, they have parted. And Father, many of us will have watched yesterday, that moving tribute, that final ceremony to mark his passing. And we ask, Lord, for your blessing upon our Queen. And we give thanks that she is one who professes faith and trust in you. And we would ask, Father, that you strengthen her as she continues to serve not only you, but this nation. And be with her family. Yes, we hear much of tensions and rifts. But Lord, through this time, we pray that you will move to work to bring a reunification, to bring understanding, to bring healing in a broken relationships. And fathers, we acknowledge that the royal family are grieving. We also ask for your peace, your presence, your blessing to be with all who mourn and grieve at this time, all those who have lost loved ones as a result of the COVID pandemic, who have found their process, the normal practices of mourning, altered. Surround them all with your love, Lord, and draw them ever closer to you. And we're mindful of those who are ill at this time, who need your touch upon their body. Yes, for physical healing, for emotional healing, for mental strength and stability, for spiritual peace. Move by your Spirit, Lord, in their lives, and let them know your guidance. And for the leaders of the nations around the world, as they strive to bring this pandemic under control, grant them in wisdom and how they go about it. In some nations, there are lockdowns being reimposed. In others, there is easing of restrictions. So we pray that guidance will be given. And that, Lord, we can return to worshipping together. We can return to living in freedom and moving about freely. So, Lord, move in a mighty way to bring a release from this pandemic. And we would also ask for wisdom and guidance and direction for the leaders of our churches, and indeed the churches around the world, so that as we witness to your love, your compassion, we may be strengthened. We may have the ability to be your servants, to speak of your love for the whole world. And Father, for our own families, for our own fellowships, we ask for your guidance and direction as we would seek to move forward through this time into what the future will hold for us. And our Methodist Church in Ireland, through their partnership with the church, the Methodist Church in Upper Myanmar, have asked us to pray for that nation today. And so we use the words provided. God of peace, we pray for wisdom and courage for the leaders and the members of the Methodist Church in Upper Myanmar. We ask for wisdom to determine the ways to challenge injustice and the courage to act. Protect the members in the midst of the restrictions, demonstrations, and violence. May there be a softening of the military hearts, release of detainees, and a return to democracy. Amidst the COVID pandemic, may all in Myanmar have access to vaccines. May the church also have wisdom and courage to speak out on behalf of the Rohingya people. Father, we pray for peace in Myanmar. And may our brothers and sisters in that land know your presence. These prayers, Lord, we come and lay before your throne of grace in the name of Jesus, our Saviour. Amen. we turn to our closing hymn at this stage. Again, it's another one taken from the hymns and Psalms, 739. Jesus, good above all others, gentle child of gentle mother. Bless one another as we say together and to each other the words of the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Amen.